Greetings, radio amateurs, streaming direct from server farms across the fruited plain with half my bandwidth tied behind my back just to make it fair. And losing my headphones from the Amateurs in Broadcasting Network. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 100. I should bang the table.
Yeah,
really, 100. Well, big whoop.
Agreed.
So, why are we here?
So I thought a celebrity introduction would be a good idea. I may be wrong. Okay, Cindy, what was your question?
Why are we here?
Because this is episode 100.
Okay.
100
so that's
is
what you've been doing all this time.
100 is a milestone.
I sit in my office next to your office, and I hear blah 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 retake blah 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 blah. So that's what's been going on. So you're up to 100 of those blah 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 blah.
Well, yeah, and in fact, Cliff, if you would go to the computer, even though this says I'm at episode 99, if we look at something like Blip here, it adds up the real number of episodes. We got 134 of them online.
How'd you get 100?
We got some rubber math here.
Yeah, really.
Yeah, which is why, okay, you can come back to us here. Which is why being at episode 100 is big whoop. I mean, it's 100 on the episode count. The last one we did was 99. But a lot of the episodes have multiple.
More than one show.
Yeah, multiple shows within them. But they're pretty much all good standalone episodes. And I started this back with episode one. Back to the computer there, Cliff. And that's the problem. Whoa.
Wow.
I really need to design a better website.
Yeah, no, it's amazing.
If we look inside episode one, what we've got, I'm sorry, not episode one. If we look inside episode two, see, that's when I started with, you know, a whole lot of shows within one episode. So, you know, it just threw the count off. Horribly. And there was no way to recover.
That's all that episode two?
That's all in episode two, oh, yeah.
Geez. No wonder, yeah.
A lot of stuff in
Let's
there.
Let's watch that after we're done.
Yeah. And so here in episode 100, I've got me, the star of the show, Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, my lovely wife, Cindy, KD4ACW. I don't think you were in episode two.
No, I've only been in the Dayton episodes.
Yeah. Kind of standing off to the side.
Yeah.
Oh, and the dipole episode.
Yeah, you were in that too.
Ever.
Yeah. And we got Jeff over there, AC4ZO. And behind the Wirecast system is Cliff, W4FT, trying madly to push buttons and keep track of all of this. You might as well just go to the wide shot and stay there.
Yeah, might as well stay there.
So episode 100. It's what I thought I would do if I don't go to the computer now because it's got all my secret stuff. Okay, go ahead to the computer for a second. There's my secret stuff. There's Rush. How is my Rush, by the way?
Very good.
I didn't like it.
Okay.
So I'm back from the Kickstarter. Now I'm back from the DCC with the successful Kickstarter. Back a little bit early because we had some minor crises here. Maybe not so minor. Cindy, was it minor or what? You know, how would you rate the crises?
It was pretty bad.
Right up on the mic there.
Yeah, it was pretty bad.
Yeah, we lost a cat.
I asked him to come home.
We lost a cat. Rennie, one of our three blind tuxedo cats, and one that you've never seen on the show because he's shy. Yeah, camera shy, everything shy, people shy. You guys seen Rennie? Any of you guys ever seen Rennie? I think you barely have.
Oh, yeah, I've seen him.
I think Jeff and Bobby have, but very few.
Yeah, oh, and Bobby's over in the peanut gallery, not on camera. Bobby made her premiere appearance on the Dipole show. So she says, don't point a camera at me. So sometime we're going to point a camera at her, but maybe not tonight. So I came back early. So for those of you that were looking forward to me stopping at various places across the country, we didn't stop any place. It was a mad dash out, which actually showed up on episode 98. Another one of those episodes that's got three shows in it. You know, so
Ricky, I didn't even know you did this one.
Yeah, you didn't watch these.
No, I haven't.
Yep, on the road with the Q-Mobile and me and talking to Jeff and Cliff. I never got to talk to you on camera. There's your mic.
No, you didn't, and you keep turning my audio down so you don't even have to listen to me.
Well, it's because we're hearing the clicking because you hit those keys as if they were, you know, you needed a sledgehammer on them. I'll leave your mic on if you can hit the keys quietly.
Well, I do it with authority.
Okay.
There you go.
You're fading out again. And you forgot to switch your picture on.
No, I didn't.
Okay. All right. So I drove out there in 5 days. You could have done it in like 3, right, Jeff?
He's a professional. Yeah, he could have done it in 3.
Long
no
distance
problem.
Is no problem.
Mm-hmm. I thought I was doing long distance.
What's the most you've done in one day? Was it 1,000 miles?
Oh, no, 1,450, okay. Something like that.
Okay, yeah.
That's what, 85 miles an hour for 24 hours straight?
My longest recent day was a week ago today. It was 9:47, but I had a four-hour service call in the middle of the day, so that ended up being a really long day.
Yeah.
Yep, I should have had you go with me. You didn't go with me because you've got a job.
Well, you know, I think we might have just a road trip coming up now for all those places you didn't go while you were gone.
I've got a feeling it's going to be a Skype trip. More than a road trip because there's really not enough money in the budget to go from here out to all those places.
We can cover a lot of miles on Skype.
Yeah, Skype is fast and easy and cheap. Yeah, just not as high quality. Anyway.
The food's not as good.
No.
Road food is pretty good.
Yeah.
So there's no extra stories. The editing on the Kickstarter stuff, the Tapper, why do I keep calling it the Kickstarter thing? The Tapper DCC is going to start soon. But I've got a bunch of programs in the pipeline before that. So I can't start them right away. Sometime, today is Wednesday. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sometime, we're out of town this weekend for your dad's birthday. Mm-hmm. W4PBT, happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Dad.
So I'll lose the weekend, which was often when I edit a lot of programs. So probably starting like Monday, Tuesday, start editing programs. Yeah, I was going to have that colonoscopy on Tuesday, but we've moved it.
Oh, will you be shooting that?
Thank you for sharing.
Well, you know, they do. They do shoot that.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
By the way, there's a mouse behind you and a bear over here.
Oh, okay, good. They're everywhere.
Yeah. Well, they're all over the place.
Yeah,
okay.
The bear's right
all
here.
All the tuxedo blind cats. What, bear? There he is.
Look who I've got.
And me.
Look at that.
Okay, like, these are two of our remaining blind tuxedo cats, which Cliff is not. Oh, okay.
Well, yeah, it's kind of hard to show them. Oh, she'll go.
Mouse lives on my shoulder.
She'll live on your shoulder. Yeah.
Yep.
You want the bear?
Bear. Come here, bear.
So we miss Rennie. Sorry, Rennie. For those of you that are pet lovers, especially cat lovers, cats and dogs, explain to them the Rainbow Bridge, Cindy. Climb right up on that microphone.
Oh, goodness. Okay, so you're going to make me cry here. Yeah, so the Rainbow Bridge is pretty much the story of how, you know, our pets cross over to a place where they're all whole again and no longer in pain, and they wait for us.
Yeah, they just sit there waiting.
They wait for us.
Well, they frolic and play.
They've got a lot of friends
see their
on
ancestors.
The other side. Yeah, but and they're basically waiting for us to when our day comes.
When we shuffle off our mortal coil.
Yes.
I should do that as Rush. When we shuffle off our mortal coil.
Good point. Okay,
one mouse?
I got a mouse.
Okay. There's a bunch of other shows that are in the pipeline before this. There's some stuff left over from Dayton. There's some stuff left over from Orlando.
Yeah.
We shot, Cliff, you were with me in Orlando, right?
Yes, I was.
Yeah, and we shot some MCOM vehicles, or a big MCOM vehicle. And then Jeff was with me at Dayton, and we shot their big MCOM vehicle. So yeah. I'm going to make one show out of those two. So that's the next thing I'm probably going to do. And then at Huntsville, I did an interview with Bob Interbitson, NQ1R, the world's worst non-vanity call sign. NQ1R. Come on, Bob. Vanity. It's vanity time. That must be a vanity. You can't get a 2x1 non-vanity. Or can you?
I don't know. How old is that call?
I'm not sure.
How long has he held it?
I don't know. Bob,
maybe a long time.
I've given him grief about that before. So anyway, we talked to him about digital QST and the Centennial, stuff like that, and the fact that the digital QST is going to come out for the Android platform. I'm not sure it's out quite yet, but I've got an Android device, a Nexus 7, and it works fairly terribly looking at QST live online, although I think he told me that something, I'll have to go play the interview back. He told me something about what I was doing wrong, where it would work better. So we'll see. Anyway, I'd like to be able to download it and look at it offline. Talk to Larry Price, W4RA. Larry is former ARL president, now a president emeritus, of the IARU. Anyway, we talked about a whole lot of really wonky stuff. It's going to be a fairly long interview. For those of you that are really deep into the wonky stuff, you're going to love this one. A lot about the WRC that's coming up in Geneva. And then a whole bunch of other stuff. We've managed, I think, practically 90 minutes worth. Super wonky.
Yeah, that'll be fun.
No, you're not going to watch that one. Yeah. Jim of Jim's Engraving. I don't have Jim's call sign. Everybody's on the other shows has a sign behind them, this lit up LED sign. And I'll be getting one when I tell them what I want, which I've been too busy to do. But I did an interview with him. And in fact, I made a commercial for him. Go to his website, Jim's Engraving, and you'll see the commercial we made at Shelby.
Hello, my name is Jim Tebow. I run a small engraving business in Pocahontas, Illinois called Jim's Engraving. The engraving that I do is all done using a sandblaster rather than a laser. The reason for that is I can get finer detail than is possible with a laser engraver, and I can get greater depth. Most of the work that I do is for the ham radio community.
And then also at Shelby, I did the most non-ham show that I've ever done, maybe the most non-ham show that I will ever do, unless this one really works out well. It is on a magazine that is coming out next year, and they're headquartered in Rock. What's that town outside of Charlotte?
Rockingham.
Rock Hill.
Rock Hill. Yeah,
That's South Carolina, by the way.
South Carolina, right? Yeah. They're headquartered there, which is why the guy was at Shelby. The magazine is called Prepped and Prepared, which is kind of redundant, isn't it? If you're prepped and prepared, you're super prepared. I talked to the guy who's going to be the publisher, well, the editor, I guess. And he, as we began the interview, was kind of pointing it in the direction of a Mother Jones. And my question was, Mother Jones, it sounds a lot more like guns and ammo to me. But he had a lot of interesting things to say. He was at the Shelby Hamfest because it was I'm not going to reveal the source because I'm not sure I can. Maybe you want to, Jeff. Someone was telling us that at VE sessions in their area, they were seeing a lot of what you call preppers.
I don't know the source of that, but I've heard that before.
Yeah, well, it was a group that we were with in Shelby. And they were saying that, at least in their area, that they were seeing a lot of preppers getting into ham radio.
Yeah, I heard the same news at Dayton.
Yes. It was at Dayton, not Shelby.
Dayton, Shelby.
I'm really worn out from this trip.
After this trip, there was a difference.
Yeah.
Sadly.
So that's what we heard. Yeah. I don't know whether it's true. I haven't heard that from around here.
Yeah.
But maybe you guys out there have heard the same thing. Anyway, you know, the prepper movement is being prepared for, well, according to the guy from the magazine, a lot of different things. You know, not just government apocalypse, but any kind of natural disaster or whatever. And, of course, communications are a big part of it. So we've got that discussion. And I guess I'm trying to have the discussion now.
I have a friend, a non-ham friend, and you wouldn't believe what he told his daughters about prepping. Their question, it was a friend of mine from Orlando, and he's got these three daughters. I think their ages are 6 to 9 years old. And they asked him one time what those spheres along the power lines that you see on some of the high-tension lines are for from time to time. And he told his daughters that
they contain food.
astronaut food. That's what he told them. So in the case of, you know, the farm farmers, severe storms, and the farmers can't produce food or, you know, whatever kind of famine, you could get that food, but that they shouldn't tell anybody because there's not enough for everybody, and only the people that know about it will be able to get it.
Well, now you revealed it.
Mm. Well, they went and told their mother, hey, we know Daddy told us what those things on the power lines are for. And she said, oh, yeah, what are they for, baby? And they freaked out. Eyes got real big, and they said, you don't know? And they just started screaming. And now this woman's got three hysterical children and doesn't know why.
They can't tell. It's a secret.
Right.
Told not to tell. So it's those things along the power lines. What transformers, right?
No.
Those spheres that's actually on the wires.
Mm-hmm. I don't know that I've ever seen them.
Yeah.
You never
have? Oh, where airports. They're going. Yeah, by airports.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. By airports?
That wouldn't be nearly enough.
I just see them all over the place.
I only see them near airports.
Yeah, when the power lines are along the right away for the runway.
Yeah,
yeah. Mm-hmm. Glide path for the runway.
They will have those out.
That's the only place I see them. Yeah. And that's not nearly enough food. That's not enough for me.
No.
And I know it's not enough for you.
Astronaut food, though.
No, the government has a special place for
those things are bigger than they look. They're way up high in the air.
Yeah, and it's freeze-dried. You know, just add water. If you can come. You know, I'm coming up with the concept of freeze-dried water. Just add water. Never mind.
We won't.
So, where was I?
Prepping.
We're done with prepping. There's a whole show on prepping coming up as soon as I get it edited. I wanted to do a little bit of history. Are we old enough to have a history?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'd
okay.
Say
why
so.
Do you say that? Climb up on that mic.
I know when your birthday is. I know what year you were born.
Oh, history of the show, not history of me.
I don't even know his age.
I'm 63.
Oh. Well, we're not so far apart.
I'm an old geezer. I gave Morse's novice test. Taught him the code. Vail taught me the code. I taught Morse. Yeah. You know that story.
Yeah.
So is Ham Radio Now old enough to have a history? Well, in fact, it is because it started in here's a pop quiz. What year did Ham Radio Now's predecessor, ARVN, get started?
I'm guessing 2005.
Pretty close.
26.
2004.
2004.
2004. Way back in 2004.
Okay.
Just after the turn of the century. Yeah. And the way it started was actually. In February 2003, the space shuttle Columbia, you might recall, broke up as it was reentering the atmosphere, and most of the pieces fell over East Texas near the town of Nacogdoches. And, you know, ham radio, I've been a public information officer guy, and talking to Alan Pitts, the media guy from ARL, and a variety of resources, you know, guys like Bill Pasternak from Newsline. And we were all commiserating about how little footage there is of hams doing emergency or any kind of ham radio stuff. Back then, particularly, but even today, there's a lot of stuff on YouTube, but, you know, it's all crap. And it's kittens and crap. There's no one shooting hams doing serious ham stuff, especially the emergency communications. ARL would like to have had footage of things that we did for media, and it doesn't exist. All the cameras out there, all the video cameras, all of the, you know, back in the day, there were way back in 2004, there were not camera phones, but there were a lot of video cameras, and nobody was shooting important stuff that hams did.
Right.
So here was this major event, and I really wanted to go. I was working freelance at that point, and my schedule for the 2 weeks around that was just chock full. Could not get away. Really wanted to. It would have been on high eight if I had been able to get away, but high eight's better than nothing. You know, long before I had the fancy cameras. So, and for those of you that don't know the story, ham. This is in the wilds of East Texas. Outside of Nacogdoches, all of the agencies, and it was an alphabet soup of agencies that came to recover pieces of the space shuttle. Few of them, none of them had good communications. The sheriff's office didn't even have good solid communications every place. So the ham repeaters that they had out there covered the territory pretty well. So the hams were enlisted big time. The hams were shadowing every agency from NASA and the FBI on down, providing communications to guide these to where there were reports of fragments, and then cataloging them and then getting them back. Hams did all that. Now, as it turns out, had I been there with my camera, I wouldn't have been there with my camera because I would have been booted out. Because this is one of those things that was just a lid was kept on it like crazy. But I interviewed some of the hams that were there. Whoever's thumping their microphone, don't do that. That would be you because you got hands on your stand. I interviewed hams and I wrote up the story. And I think I was doing a column in CQVHF, the FM and repeater column. And, well, it was an FM story, a repeater story. So that's where it ended up. And I had a really good time talking to a bunch of people out there and doing the interviews. But we didn't get almost any pictures and certainly no video footage out of that one. So I really wanted to be able to do this stuff. Well, 2004 was the year I decided to get serious about doing it and acquired some equipment. 2004 is also the year that Leo Laporte started TWIT. Look where TWIT is. Look where I am.
Yeah, we're in our house. Yeah,
Leo had a few more resources. Well, he started in something like this. So I began when I recognized that there was a significant event about to happen at Field Day in 2004. The W3AO operation, the combination of the Columbia Amateur Radio Club and the PVRC, the Potomac Valley Radio Club, right, was about to do their Field Day along with everybody else. And the previous year, they were 51A. 51A. That was huge. Yeah. So I'm going, wait a minute. I remember working those guys, and we all didn't believe it when we heard their report, 51A. And I'm thinking, they did something squirrely. I don't know what they did, but it was squirrely, and it couldn't have been really 51A. But I want to go find out. So I called Roald Anders, K3RA, who was in charge of the event that year, and said, "Can I come? Can I shoot it?" You know, I didn't have a name at that point. In fact, I made up the name ARVN on the way up there, and had a friend get a website for me. ARVN's not available. ARVN is the, as I'm often told by old hams, the Army of the Republic of Vietnam. You don't need to tell me that anymore. So they don't have the initials ARVN. ARVN.com is at a one of those warehouses for domain names.
Right.
They want thousands of dollars for it. No one's going to pay them for that. I did get ARVN.tv. They didn't think about the TV. Mm-hmm. Nobody thinks about the .tv. I got that eventually. This is my lack of planning. I got in engineers, and I'm not an engineer, but I have some engineer mentality. And engineers shortcut think. I got the website arvidnews.com. arvidnews.com. What an idiot. I could never explain that to anybody.
No.
It's arvidnews.com. Well, Google me. ARVN. Actually, if you Google let's Google ARVN. ARVN, let's see who comes up. The number one answer is the Army of the Republic of Vietnam. Look who's number two.
Amateur radio video news. Yeah.
We're number two. We try harder.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're number four.
Hey, there was the AR vid news, or was it AR video news, did it look like on the link there? ARVideoNews.com.
Yeah, AR video news is what I got after AR vid news was stupid.
Yeah.
And I didn't want amateur radio video news. All of that.
That's pretty long.
all of that is why I eventually became Ham Radio Now.
Much easier.
That is better.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I got hamradionow.com, but I branded as hamradionow.tv because I'm a Leo head.
Mm-hmm.
And we're television. I like that stuff. Okay. So back to my list here. So we went up there and shot the event. Didn't edit it and get it out on a DVD until 2011. 2004, 2011. What was I doing in the meantime? And I had my first assistant on that shoot, Chris Plumley. What's Chris? WF3C is his call sign now. Shout out to Chris. Thanks for your help. He got a cameo as we were getting our boom mic fixed. He got an on-camera line. Eureka, it works. That was his line. I fed him that line the way I feed you lines.
Oh, good.
Back in the day. So I did other stuff in 2004, and I shot so much stuff, I felt overwhelmed and couldn't actually get anything edited. I did a road trip all the way up to Newington and through Pennsylvania and New York for BPL. Remember BPL?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I remember the show.
Yeah, not Brass Pounders League.
I especially remember the issue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I never did a show. I shot a lot of video, but BPL, I procrastinated on getting the stuff edited. It was just a huge mass of stuff. And eventually BPL kind of disappeared as an issue in ham radio.
I thought I remember seeing footage you did near Alexandria, Virginia, where you showed good pictures of the the links on the power lines and so forth.
The footage got used. ARL used some of it, little bits of it.
It wasn't your show.
But I didn't make a show.
Oh.
I think I did make a DVD, but I never really sold it anyplace. So, yeah, something existed from that. What else did I do back then? Hurricane Charlie hit Florida down by Daytona. I drove down there. Thought, well, here's another opportunity to get hams actually doing stuff in an emergency situation. So I headed down to Florida. You remember that?
Oh yeah.
Because you were on the phone with me.
Some of our hometown hams went too.
You were on the phone with me booking hotel rooms and giving me directions.
Sounds familiar, like I did this past trip.
Yeah. Get up on that microphone.
Yeah.
The internet wasn't what it was in 2004. It existed. You could do stuff online, but mobile internet wasn't there. So I was relying on Cindy. Cindy was mission control. Mm-hmm. We're on the phone a lot.
Travel agent.
Yeah, looking stuff. So I got down to Volusia County, which is where the Daytona Speedway is. They had a water and food and supply, an ice station set up for people. What was weird about that was the effects at that point. I got down there as the hurricane was just leaving the other side of Florida. So I was down there pretty quickly. The damage was very sporadic. It was very isolated. Big areas were out, but big areas still worked. So I spent the afternoon doing interviews with and shooting at this station where there was a ham who was providing the communications for this supply station. And lines of cars coming in, people picking up ice and water and food. And a half a mile away, I had lunch at Crystal. Crystal Hamburgers is one of my favorite places. Well, lots of people were. You know, some folks were out and were going to be out for weeks, and some folks still had power. So that also never made it into a program. The footage, some of it did get up to ARL, and they used it for some PR stuff. And some other folks actually asked if I had any footage like that for another program that they did, and I sent the footage on to them. So 2005, Hurricane Katrina. No, I didn't go to Katrina. Once again, too much freelance work. Couldn't get away. I had heard from Alan Pitts that somebody else was going down there and was going to shoot video, and somebody did, and little bits of video came out. They were going to do a big program. They never did. So I don't feel quite so bad. Because that program also never got made. And that was probably our number one opportunity, because we had just so much ham radio activity going on. Not some of it was in New Orleans, but more significantly, it was up and down the rural areas on the Mississippi and Louisiana line. Those rural counties were devastated, and they had no communications till the hams arrived. So we were extremely important at those locations, very little documentation of what went on. 2006, my first documentary that actually got done.
Oh, yes. The Tick Fest.
That's what
How
you
many
remember
did I pull off of you?
That's what you remember from it, don't
you? About 30 ticks off of you.
Yeah, it was the ARDF Championships in 2006, and they happened to be just down the road in a state park that is a mile from here.
What's ARDF? I know the DF.
Yeah, Amateur Radio Direction Finding. I haven't put this show on the web yet. I keep intending to, and I should, because they're just about to have another one in a week or so over by Asheboro. Also in North Carolina.
Oh, okay. So, not far from here.
But so I went up and I knew the guy that was coordinating it, Charles Charlo, NZ0I. Mm-hmm. So I went up there and shot with the camera that I had. I had bought the camera just before going up to W3AO, field day operation, the year before. And, hauled that camera up and down the coast for the BPL stuff. So I took the camera over to the local park. By that time, I had a little bit better wireless arrangement. Recruited another assistant.
Okay, it's time for us to get on the trails. And by us, I mean Steve Worley, KD4HDQ, and to a lesser extent, me.
Somebody in much better shape than I am, someone who could run, because a lot of this activity is, if you're familiar with orienteering, it's finding flags that have been hidden out in a park using topographic maps, mm-hmm. and watch the show. It's all on the show.
Well, I suppose I need to explain the sport of orienteering. You get a compass and a map, a very detailed map of something like this park that shows landmarks and terrain elevation and stuff. Somebody goes out and hides a few orange and white flags, or actually called controls, out in the woods, and they mark the locations on your map. And off you go. Since the person who finds them all the fastest is the winner, you do a lot of running. With radio orienteering, the control flags are not marked on the map. You put a transmitter at each flag, and you have a receiver and a directional antenna, and off you go.
I did a lot of fox hunting when I was a kid, 6 meter AM and then 2 meter FM. And we would drive around in cars. If we walked 20 feet at the end, that was a lot of physical stuff. Yeah. We had a mast stuck up out the window of the car and a beam of some kind. 6 meters, a horizontal, typically 3-element 6-meter beam, which covered up the whole top of the car. And I went out with a friend of mine, Rick, WA9KAW, and his dad, Walt, WA9BOX. And we had this 3-element 6-meter beam on top of their 57 Chevy. And we pull into a gas station with this thing sitting on top of the... And in those days, they pumped the gas for you. No self-service. Do you know Oregon doesn't have self-service?
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, New Jersey doesn't. At least parts of Oregon don't. Because I was out there and I was going to pump the gas, and the guy walks up and says, oh, I'll do that for you.
Liability fears or something?
I don't know.
Union. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
It is in Jersey.
So so we pull up to this gas station. The guy comes up to us. What do? Put the car on the roof at night?
That's pretty good. That is funny.
he got something out of it. Mm-hmm. So anyway, but I digress. So I actually got that shot and produced. I like
that video. That is a good one.
When did I produce it? Copyrighted it in 2008. Okay, so wow. It took a while.
Yeah.
I shot it in 2006. Hmm. That one came out in 2008. But that was the first one that I actually produced and sold. And it did okay. It sold a few hundred copies. Maybe up to almost 300 by now. I keep thinking the shows like this ought to be more in the 3,000 copy range. But it is what it is.
Hard to get the word out.
Hams, they're cheap. So I've been told. 2007. You hold this one up to your camera.
Oh, okay. What is it?
It's you.
Your camera's way over there.
Ah, there we are.
There we go.
That one. It's all this high-tech equipment.
Yep. 2007, the first program I did and produced the same year that I shot it, the Dayton tour, with Jeff, AC4ZO, the Dayton Virgin. Mm-hmm. And that's your initial inaugural appearance.
Yeah.
In those days, I wasn't appearing on camera so much. I did a little bit at the beginning, of the ARDF, and a little bit at the end. Mm-hmm. But mostly, I was in your Ken Burns silent, omniscient narrator. Not silent, but the...
Well, you know, you were shooting hams doing ham stuff, which was your original calling.
Yeah, the disembodied voice. It was the disembodied voice of the voiceover announcer. And a little bit at the beginning, and that was about it. So on that, you were my on-camera guy. Yeah. You know, I showed up very little.
Looked really good, too, huh?
Yeah. So, and funny. You know why you were so funny?
It's just what I do.
I told you what to say.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, not all the time. A lot of the times you were funny all by yourself. Mm-hmm. So there was that. That was in 2007. In 2007 through 2009, something that has nothing to do with ham radio, but everything to do with being able to do these programs, I was the voice of, not the roaming gnome, the announcer on the Travelocity commercials that had the roaming gnome.
Mm-hmm. There he is.
Yep.
The roaming gnome. I was the guy that said, Travelocity presents the roaming gnome, denouncer of travel myths. And did... I think about 6 television commercials, again, not on camera, just the voice, and about 30 radio commercials. The 6 television commercials paid more as 6 television commercials than all the radio did mm-hmm. put together.
It made our mailbox an ATM, essentially.
Yeah, climb up on that microphone.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, Cindy called the mailbox the ATM. Mm-hmm.
There's a check in it every day.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Almost every day.
Yeah.
So it paid for the Q-mobile, which you've now seen on some of the episodes, and all the equipment that's in it. And all of this editing equipment and the cameras, the first generation of cameras, the standard definition camera, the second generation of cameras, the high def cameras, and the editing stuff, and a fattened up a 401k, which then in 2008 became a 201k, like everybody else. And by the way, it's all gone.
I told everybody I knew that I was good friends with the announcer for the Roaming Gnome, and I didn't even get a beer out of it.
You're right. You got nothing. I owe you dinner or something, I guess. For what? For being my friend?
It's what friends do.
I believe I took care of you at Dayton and the trips that we've made on the road.
7 years.
Yeah. So.
Lots of White Castle.
we do that.
Steak and Shake.
Not a lot of White Castle or Crystals, though.
Lots of Steak and Shake, though.
Lots of Steak and Shake.
And we like that.
Oh, we love it.
Yeah. It took care of Cliff, too.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, he did. Crystals every night.
It was not.
Crystals every night and Subway every afternoon.
You're supposed to push the button that puts your face on camera if you do that.
I'm not.
He's in charge.
He's got the buttons.
He gets to pick.
Okay, where are we? Well, we're way behind schedule.
Excuse me.
Another one. This program, which I no longer have any of the DVDs with their original cover. That's the original cover of the DVD, and I sold them all. I printed 300 or so them all, and I made a few more. A digital voice for amateur radio, and that was probably my biggest road trip until this last Seattle thing. I went to Chicago, Dallas, St. Louis, Alabama, lots of interviews, and a really spectacular documentary program. Once again, me on the front for a little bit. You made the front of that. I was your first on-camera position. Not Jeff, Cindy.
Me?
Yeah, you don't remember?
No, what'd I do?
We were down in our living room, and I was shooting the introduction.
Oh, that one, yeah. Okay, now I remember. Yeah, unfortunately, I remember now. Thank you.
What was the problem?
The problem was I had my granny glasses on because I couldn't see the viewfinder and the little bitty camera that you had. So I had, and then you shot me, and I don't think I had any makeup or anything that day. I wasn't expecting to be on TV.
Yeah, but you were way behind the camera. No one could see you or anything.
Yeah, right.
So Cindy's at the beginning of that program. The first half was with Mel Witten, K0PFX. Mel, you've seen on many programs now. who's big in HF digital voice, and then D-Star and P25. One of the interviews I did in Chicago was on P25. Moto Turbo was not around yet. None of the other stuff was actually out. So that one I actually produced and got online, not online, on DVD.
For sale.
Pretty soon.
That was a popular one. That was a great program.
I would put that online now, but it is way out of date. There's a lot of stuff that has happened in D-Star particularly that is not on that program. So I'm not sure what to do about it. What I want to do is take elements of it because it's good introduction and then sit here and add some of the new stuff when I get some time.
You don't think it has historical value the way it is?
Well, it will confuse people because things are missing. Yeah. The entire linking system that is now the predominant linking system used in D-Star is not there at all. And the DV dongle is just barely there. The DVAP's not there.
What I mean by historical perspective is not useful from a technological point of view, but of interest of what things were like then. Even though it wasn't that long ago.
That's true. Well,
it's interesting to look in the mirror and see where we came from.
I think if I get it online with some updates, all of the historical stuff will still very much be there. Just have to get around to it. 2008, the first year that I did the Tapper Digital Communications Conference. It was in Chicago, drove up there, had some volunteer camera operators, and did the multi-camera shoot. And brought it back. It was not a Ham Radio Now. I'm starting to put some of these online, but they're still available as DVDs. In fact, I've got one of them that I will hold up. I think this is my favorite, not just from 2008, but from just about anything that they did at a Tapper conference. And most of the talks at the Tapper conferences are really good. Some are kind of wonky and boring. But most are really, really good. But they're sort of going to appeal to people in different areas of ham radio. This one, everybody ought to watch. And I have put this online. It is called Software Radio Through the Looking Glass. It is Phil Harmon, VK3APH. Phil is the guy that wrote the software for the Mercury receiver, part of the high-performance software-defined radio deal that Tapper was supporting. I don't know how much you've been following software-defined radio. It's becoming a thing in ham radio. Flex is software-defined radio. Elecraft is software-defined radio. And these guys were doing it a little earlier than everybody else. But the thing in 2008 with the Mercury receiver was the first time that anybody did this. Antenna, filter, A to D converter. You should all be going... Wow. Cliff, take a shot of them. That's not easy to do. It was easy to do back then if you had hundreds of thousands of dollars to pour into a system. But for Tapper, they didn't. They wanted to be able to do it for hundreds of dollars, not in less than 1,000 or in the low thousands. So getting out of your antenna connector through a filter, you got to go through a filter. You got to get rid of something. And then the A-D converter. And their spectrum was from close to DC up to 60 megahertz. Flex's new system, the Series 6, has gone beyond that. But they were doing this in 2008. And that's the concept. Flex's Series 6 is the first ham radio SDRs to do basically antenna, filter, A-D converter. Before that, Flex went through a stage or two of conversion in the analog domain, which they say the reason for not doing that is it adds distortion. So, and Elecraft is still doing that. And Alinco, I understand, has now got a some kind of a software-defined radio that I really don't know enough about other than that it exists. But I'm sure it's also going through a stage or two of analog conversion before they go digital.
The Flex I got pretty familiar with after we got back from Dayton. I was thinking about buying the 6000 and read everything I could on it and decided it wasn't ready yet. Well, it was barely shipping by that time. But I read about a lot of problems.
I talked to Greg. That interview is online. I talked to Greg Jurens at Huntsville, and he talked about some of the problems that they had.
I was late getting out on that one.
Yep. So, so you can see what they're talking about.
But our local club has a speaker about Flex Radio next month, the November meeting.
It should be interesting because it's from the user's perspective. Okay, 2009 also did some more Dayton.
When did you do Standing Up for Standing Waves? That was a very popular DVD. Well, the one that was. I got to man your booth during Dayton, and I sold quite a few copies of that. I can't remember when that was done.
You know, I bypassed that on here by accident because I made the font too small and I can't see it with these glasses on.
What year was that?
2005.
Wow.
I shot Standing Up for Standing Waves. Have I even got one here?
I don't think so.
Don't have one sitting here next to me.
It was a fun-to-watch demonstration.
That was the first DVD I actually put out. And I haven't put it online because it's not my show. It belongs to the guy who made the presentation, Bill. Can't remember his last name. Anyway, I shot it at a board meeting of the Southeastern Repeater Association. They have their meetings. They gather everybody from the 8 Southeastern states in Sevierville, Tennessee. And they start their meeting Saturday afternoon. For the folks that come in Friday, they got Saturday morning available. And they try to have some kind of a training thing. So they brought the guy in who does this presentation. That's what the DVD looks like.
Bill Hayes.
That's what Bill Hayes looks like. That's what Bill Hayes looks like. Anyway, you can see a little bit of the stuff that he gets set up. And there's still a preview online. You can watch that. So, yeah, that was actually the first one that I actually got produced. Mm-hmm. And that sold pretty well, too. That's in the 400 or 500 copy range. So I still get orders from it every couple of weeks, and I have to burn one because it ran through all of the copies that I had professionally produced. So I'll burn you one and send it on. It's $10 plus shipping, $3 shipping in the U.S. It's a really good demonstration of Standing Wave. If you've had a hard time understanding it, it gets a little wonky. Agreed. Here and there.
I liked it. I liked the program.
Yeah, and I almost understand all of it. So sorry about forgetting that, and thank you for bringing that up.
I sold quite a few, so I remember. Yeah.
So let's see, where am I? Our digital voice. 2008, we shot the D-Star Forum and the afternoon forum and the evening meeting at Dayton. That was historic. All of the people that were involved in bringing D-Star to the U.S. from ICOM and more just hams who fell in love with this new technology, they're all there, especially at the Friday night event. Yeah. And they all tell their story a little bit, and they have a lot of fun. So that's still available, I think, only on DVD, but I'll put that online. 2009, we shot Dayton Forums. 2008, we shot Dayton Tour and Forums. We shot them in 2008. I didn't get them edited.
Yes.
The tour doesn't change much from year to year.
Are we seeing a sort of a theme? Yeah, theme.
Yeah, procrastination. Theme, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got better.
So 2008 and 2009 got put together as one program. Yeah. The tours are fun. We kid people. We have a good time. Mm-hmm. We're not serious. We do show new stuff.
Ham radio is serious stuff. I'm serious on the tour.
Yeah, you
watch one and you'll see.
Very serious. 2011 DCC. 2010 the DCC went to Portland, Oregon. I couldn't afford to go. 2011 it returned to the east to Baltimore. I went. Cliff, you went with me, I think.
Yes, I did.
And 2011 I decided to release the DCC video online. And I put it on ARVN. We were still ARVN back then. And all of the programs are here for you to stream online, just in case you're watching this and you missed them. But you kind of got to go to the ARVN site. I have a little link to them on the Ham Radio Now site. But they're all online. The first year, when I sold DVDs, I sold about $9,000 worth, and it cost a couple thousand dollars to do. So I made $5,000 or $6,000. The second year, DVD sales fell off. Expenses were the same. DVD sales fell off to about $6,500. So I'm thinking, online is the way to go. DVDs are so 20th century. So I put them online. I hadn't done anything else online. Ham Radio Now hadn't gotten started. I asked for contributions. Contributions totaled up a whopping $2,500. Oh, you guys, you are so damn cheap.
Told you.
Thousands of people watched. You know, I sold hundreds of the titles from the DCC on DVD and made $6,000 to $9,000. Thousands of people, thousands of you watched, and every one of them had me at the beginning saying, cough up. This wasn't cheap to do. I don't go to McDonald's and get a Happy Meal just because I'm a good guy and make videos. You know, they want $6. So, so damn cheap, $2,500 or so. So of course, I did it again in 2011. And I also came up with this brilliant idea. I have these brainstorms in the middle of the night in fevered sleep to change things to Ham Radio Now and do everything online and buy a bunch of expensive high-definition equipment and started off at Orlando in 2011. And that's when Cliff went with me. So Ham Radio Now began in 2011. I need my timeline here. I'm going to lose the deal. Did I say 2011? I don't think it started until 2012. This is 2013, right?
Oh, you said early 2012.
A year here and there with, you know,
yeah,
with your show.
Yeah, well, matter.
Yeah, it was coming back from the Daytonhamvention in 2011 that I got the call from Bob Heil, and they were starting Ham Nation. And he asked if I could be the guest host. He knew he wasn't going to be around for all the programs because he has a big convention schedule. Yeah. So he's on the road a lot. And he knew that in the very first year, he needed somebody with some expertise at doing this sort of stuff to fill in when he was going to be out of town. So I remember what I said was, well, yeah, just don't ask me to do it full time.
And here you are.
So I had never heard of Twit, Leo Laporte. I had put preview videos on YouTube. So it was my preview videos and cat videos. That's what I knew about YouTube. That's what I knew about online. No idea about all the rest of this stuff. So I'm saying, what's Twit? What's Leo Laporte? What is all this stuff? And he said, well, go watch it. So I started watching that. Leo was still back in the cottage back then. So he was a shoestring operation, but he was putting 20 shows online every week at that point. And I fell in love with that stuff and also realized online is where it has to be. So I did Ham Nation. I think I did 6 or 7 episodes of Ham Nation, and Bob stopped calling. I don't know exactly why. He never told me why he stopped calling me to be the guest host. He never told me. He never said a word. He just stopped calling. He did help me with one promotion when I got Ham Radio Now started after the Orlando deal, because I had shot some video for the show from Orlando.
Right.
I made a little package, and he brought me on, and we played the package, and I got to talk about Ham Radio Now. And I thought I was going to be the guest host on that show, but no, he was there, so I was a guest, and that was it. That was my last appearance on Ham Nation, and not another word.
I wonder if the reason was similar to that gig you had in Lake Havasu City where they quit calling you there, too. But there you got a reason why.
Yeah, I was a disc jockey in Lake Havasu City, and I got fired for talking too much about the wrong stuff. Well, yeah, I can only speculate that Bob didn't like the direction I went with Ham Nation.
Yeah,
but there's something else that I haven't told anybody online here, but I'm pretty transparent about it. I hated what he was doing with Ham Nation. I thought he was being Mr. Rogers, and it was everything was wonderful, everything was good, and hams were children, and we were talking to them like children, and the interviews were terrible, and I wanted to do something more professional, and all he wanted me to do was get on to the next thing faster. Gordon is Gordon. You know, Gordon is a lovable goofball. You know, he's not going to be any different. And so George, when George started coming on doing Smoke and Solder, George is George. You know, he's very straightforward, kind of low on the charisma scale, but we talked about that in the episode that's on. And I talked to Randy about that too. You know, they're not trying to be broadcast professionals. They're just being themselves, which is fine. And so I've gotten over it. Ham Nation is being very successful. They have their formula, they're doing what they want to do. And I am trying to do something that is maybe a notch up on the professionalism scale that I don't think any ham cares about. You know, some hams care about it. A few hams care about it a lot and tell me about it. But most hams don't care. Most hams either don't see it or if they see it, they don't care. So I think that's the story. I didn't talk a lot about what I was thinking about the program back then, but I told enough people. It probably got back to Bob, and Bob said, we don't need criticism from within the ranks. So, and you know, he didn't tell me what he was thinking about, and I didn't tell him what I was thinking about. So just to be fair, you know, I didn't say, Bob, let's take the game up a notch. I just did it when I was on there.
Well, I think that gave you a good experience, though, and that's how you got where you are right now, having your own show. So I think
all in all,
it's very positive.
Yeah. Yeah. As I saw that I was going to be less involved in Ham Nation, mm-hmm. and I was
that's
thinking...
That's when you started trying to make your own way.
Yeah. We'll do the Ham Radio Now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we are what we are. You know, when I was talking to George and Tommy at Huntsville about their success of their show, as from being tied in so closely to Ham Nation, but his amateur logic has also taken off. They get thousands more views than we do. We're doing what we do, and we'll get the audience we get. I started out by thinking I want 10,000 hams at $10 a piece. Today I would be happy for 1,000 hams at $100 a year, same amount of money, and more likelihood of something like that happening at some point. I want to share a few things with you about the background of Ham Radio Now. Let me see if I can get to the right spot here. Our viewer statistics. The first couple shows up here in the top are way below what those shows have actually seen. And this is the view totals. Because something happened with YouTube. And Blip, which is the host for the shows, was forwarding things on to YouTube and combining the stats. And a few shows ago, they stopped forwarding to YouTube. Something went wrong. I think YouTube changed their login procedures, and Blip is no longer recognizing the login. So these numbers are a little bit low, and we'll go take a look at what's really happening over on YouTube, where some of these shows get a lot more views. But going back to where things were still connected, the Young Ham of the Year, 800. Ward Silver interview, 700. And then the Kickstarter show, over 1,000. The QRP show. Some of these programs get astronomical numbers because of the folks that are interested in it. And let me say something to you folks out there on camera in television land. Don't just watch the shows that you're interested in the subject matter. I mean, if you're a QRPer, don't just watch the QRP show. Watch all the other shows, because the QRP show was not for you. The QRP show was for other hams who wanted to learn a little bit about QRP, but weren't in the middle of it already and may never be. These programs are not for the enthusiasts in their subject matter. Back me up on this, Jeff.
Well, see, again, you are so much more sophisticated than I am. I like Randy, and I like George, and I love what they're doing. And I watch shows that have subject matter that I know and that I'm interested in.
How do you learn about something that you don't know?
Well, you're starting to uncover the problem now, aren't you?
Yeah. Well, that's why I'm yelling at you people out there. Watch the shows that aren't down your wheelhouse, that are not right what you want. Because all you're going to see in the shows that are, I mean, if you're a QRP or you watch the QRP show, all you're going to do is tick off the things we get wrong. You know, oh yeah, he screwed that up. Oh, he doesn't know what he's talking about.
Oh, you know, they make a movie about firefighting and the firemen grumble. They make a movie about...
Wake up, Cliff.
Know, a Western.
Push the buttons.
And the cowboys grumble. So that's just movie making.
Cliff is getting so engaged in the conversation, he's watching us.
Turn my mic up.
There you go.
You're scaring away half your audience. You should tell them to watch everything. Let them criticize it. Let them have fun doing it.
Yeah, I'm not saying don't watch the shows you know something about. I'm saying watch every... Well, what? no one's going to watch everything. I'm now putting out too much stuff. You know, from starting shooting something in 2004 and putting it out in 2011, we're now shooting something Monday and putting it out Monday.
Yeah.
This is too late on Wednesday night to put this out Wednesday night, but it'll be online Thursday. Yeah, this will be up episode 100, our big celebration. Hats and horns, you know, and that. Why didn't I get the...
We should have brought balloons and party favors.
Yeah, you should have had a happy 100 balloon in the back. Yeah. You can get them for let's say 100 birthday, but...
Maybe we could all say something together or something.
We can do that at the end.
Okay.
So, too many shows for everybody to watch everything. Although I would like to mention, we'll take a look at this. Here's the magic secret for those of you that don't have time to watch all the video. There it is. Download the audio. When I'm watching Twitch shows, I'm mostly not watching Twitch shows. I'm mostly listening to Twitch shows because I don't have time to watch them, but I can download them. I don't have the audio thing set up as well as I could. It should appear on all the podcatchers, and it doesn't. And in part, that's because I don't know how. I don't know how to get there. I could learn. I've sort of skimmed some articles that talk about how to do it, but I haven't gone through the step-by-step to get that done. But sooner or later, you'll be able to easily get the audio the way you get the audio on any other podcast.
Right.
But for now, you can download it from the website. Now the computer. There we go. Just download it from the website. And listen while you're doing other stuff. While you're driving, while you're working out.
We listen to them all the way to Dayton and back every year.
Yeah.
Well, not yours, but...
Well, we actually did listen to one of mine.
One of yours and a lot of Leo's.
And your reaction to listening to that one show that we did that you listened to as a radio show was, do you remember?
No, I don't even remember listening to it. But I do remember that it was surprisingly easy to follow without the video. In fact, that particular one, I don't think the video would have added much at all.
No, a lot of the shows are talking head shows. And the video, this is an example of a pretty darn good radio show.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're doing the twit thing and what a lot of other podcasters do. We got the big microphone sitting in front of our faces.
Right.
You know, if this were really trying to be television, we'd have the lavaliers. They'd sound terrible, but we'd have the lavaliers in front of us. And they would seem like television shows. This is, well, it's a hybrid, but it's not like nobody does it. Even in the big time, they do it. ESPN does shows like this.
Yeah. You've always wanted your sound to be superior, though.
Yeah. Well, that's because of my voice. If you had this voice, wouldn't you want this microphone?
Yes, I'm sure I would.
Transcribe it. You sound pretty good, too. Let's see. Now, where the heck am I?
You were going to do YouTube stats?
Oh, yes. I was doing stats, and now I've lost it. Oh, YouTube. Okay, so let's take a look at YouTube. Here's some of the shows on YouTube. So we did that episode 99 with Dennis Motzenbacher, introducing the Yaesu digital repeater. So 3,129 views. That's mostly due to people seeing it on QRZ.com and also getting it a little viral, spreading the word. Everybody who's interested in this digital voice stuff is telling everybody else. And that's something else you guys need to do. Tell everybody else. Don't sit there and watch it and hog it to yourself. Tell everybody you know. If you like a show, spread the word. That's the way this is actually going to get someplace. So back to the YouTube page there for a second. So some of these shows, we'd have to add like the Ward Silver show, 630 views there, and over on Blip, what did he get? 700. So he's in the 1,300 or so. Do the math for me, Jeff. 700, 600. About 1,300 or so.
Yeah.
So, that's doing well. Anything over 1,000, I'm pretty happy with. Although I'd really like to see those 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 views on all of the shows. And I think they're worth it. So, working our way there. We are already now officially over time. But I wanted to show you a couple more things. This is the money. Who else is going to show you this? Show me the money.
This is why I have to work.
Yeah. Cindy's got the big high-paying job in technology. She supports the household I play. This is not all the money. I make money free.
I You're getting the look. I'm getting that hole deeper, honey.
Stink
just keep
eye
going.
From Cindy. All right. Last year to this point, $4,500 to this point. This year to this point, which is all we can do, $17,699. Now that's got the Kickstarter in it.
Yeah, how much of that was the Kickstarter?
Yeah, we take the Kickstarter out, it's $6,033. Right. So it's doing better. I mean, it shows an increase of $1,500 or so from the 4,000 some to 6,000. So, but that is not a full time for the amount of, I'm putting in nearly full time time. Would you work for that and you take expenses out of that, you know, which uses up most of it? You know, so I'm working for nothing, basically, is how this works out. Any final comments on the end of episode 100?
No, it's fun to be over here again. It's been a while now since I've been around the KN4AQTH, so to speak.
We can do more like this, you know. Now we will do more. We've got the ham shack in the background, you know, instead of my editing station,
yeah,
with just a computer sitting in the background showing the website. The ham shack that you built, wide shot would be good here, Cliff. There we go. So
just a small piece of it.
And I'll do the Skypes from here. If I can get you in to do the Skypes, we'll do it that way.
Okay.
But you have a real job.
Yeah.
They expect you to be at work 60, 70 hours a week.
Oh, they whine. You wouldn't believe how they whine when I want time off, even to leave. You know, hey, boss, I really got something going on this weekend. I really need to leave early today, you know, and it'll be Friday. This will be at 8 or 9 in the morning, and it's coming as, you mean, like 10 or 15 minutes or something?
When I take you to Dayton, it's a disaster for them.
Mm. I have to book that the first of the year for a May trip, yeah.
But speaking of people who have jobs, Cindy, you were seriously employed. So,
yeah, thank goodness.
Just lucky to have you here on this show tonight.
Yeah.
And I would put you on more shows. You're popular. People would like to see you. But you're just
not understandable, but not available.
Yeah. So, during the day, the weekdays, when I'm not at a freelance client, which is most of the time, I'll be able to do the Skype interviews with people that can do it during the day. In the evening, when people can do it in the evening, weekends, when they can do that. So now that I've got the Wirecast system, things will go quicker and easier, and we'll put up more shows that you won't have time to watch. So any last comments on 100 from you, Cindy?
Back.
Oh, congratulations. That explains what's been going on in here for the past couple of years. Because I'm
Cliff,
busy.
She's talking. There you go.
Yeah, I'm next door working in my office, and I'm just hearing the blah, 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 and, you know, repeat of blah, 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 blah. So that explains what's been going on over here.
Yep.
I just didn't realize it was so prolific.
Yeah, and it is. Cliff, anything that you got the camera pointed back at you. Your mic's open.
Yeah, there's it's been fun. A couple of trips to Orlando, a couple of DCCs, and trying to get everything done. I think this is the first time we've all been together on one show.
It is.
Yeah, I think so.
Yep. So that will be it for episode 100. It was a show of nothing. This is a Seinfeld episode. So all together now, we will sign things. Show them Arvin there, Jeff.
Oh, here he is.
Yeah.
Don't forget the pig.
If you like Ham Radio Now, Ham Radio Now is supported by you. Well, the Tapper stuff is supported by a remarkably successful Kickstarter.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to thank the 115 hams who contributed about $6,000 or so.
That's great.
Tapper.
That's awesome.
And Flex Radio Systems and Ellicraft, who were the three corporate supporters that together made the next $6,000. And you'll be seeing something you've never seen in a Ham Radio Now show before, commercials. Because for their support, they're getting, I'm calling it enhanced underwriting, like PBS.
Nice. Yeah.
We'll try to do them Leo-like, you know, the low-key, not a sales pitch. So something like that. But we haven't made them yet, so you'll be seeing those. Your program will be interrupted at the beginning, just to mention who was supporting them, and then in the middle, one of the underwriters per show for a minute or so, somewhere in the middle, just one. So not too obnoxious. I have spent my career making television commercials. Television commercials are obnoxious. I am responsible for obnoxious television commercials. There's two reasons why I never have to watch commercials. I feel just fine skipping past them on DVRs. The first is I've seen my lifetime supply of every television commercial ever made. And but if I work on a commercial, you should watch it because that's where I make my money. The second reason is they ain't for me. They're not making them. There's one group of commercials that is made for me. The ones you see on the nightly news. Cialis, Depends, Viagra, a range of other drugs, and on some late night shows where they have the seat you sit on and it runs you up your stairway.
We'll have to be getting that soon.
I've fallen and I can't get up. They're making those for me. Those I have to watch. Yeah.
Those are more like infomercials than 30 second spots.
Some of them are just commercials.
And most commercials don't say much to me either. They give a lot of information, but not the kind of information I want.
You are now in your late 50s.
Oh, yes. I'm 50, 50.
18 to 49. Yeah. 49 and up is, we don't care about you anymore.
Once I turned about 30, though, the commercials didn't have what I wanted.
And in part because below that age, although there is a fair amount of brand loyalty, it can be swayed by advertising. Really can. Mm-hmm. Above that, brand loyalty is so locked in, or you have seen it all and
you're just desensitized to it.
Yeah, you're not going to be swayed by much. Yeah. I will still see ads for some things where I'm actually informed. I realize the ad is not informing me very well, but it's something I'm going to go check out. And I may buy something. That's pretty rare. Yeah. But they're not for me. Your folks, Cindy, your folks keep complaining about what's on television.
Mm-hmm.
The programs and the ads. And they're in their 80s. Well, your mom's not quite, but your dad's in his 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Mom's late 70s. I keep saying the same thing. They're not for you.
Right.
They're not making this stuff for you. Lawrence Welk went off the air 30 years ago. The last program made for you.
You can still see him on PBS.
Well, yeah, the reruns are still there. Turn on the bubble machine. And the one, and the two. Mm. Let's wrap this puppy up.
All right.
Okay, that's it for episode 100, our celebratory episode. Cliff, you're going to have to put yourself on camera for a second, and you can do the first part.
Okay. Now if I can just, I'm stuck here behind the buttons. I forgot what the first part is.
The first part is just one simple word.
Over.
Stare right into your camera.
Okay, at the end of episode 100, over.
And now switch to the wide shot. All of us together, 3, 2, 1.
And out. That's corny.